announcement. All of you know the problems is mobile classes in a lecture. So please either switch off or keep it inside. We will also record in the conversation. So we expect these metal chairs are horrible. They cause a lot of room. So if you don't move the chair, that is much appreciated.
So, am I audible at the back? Yes. Okay, good. And the outset, let me thank the organizers for inviting me to be with you this evening. And thanks to Professor for the kind introduction. Now, it's a really very important moment that we are coming together. The problems are what we would view, I assume, in this hall are some of the major problems that are coming facing science, practice of science, the raising scientific temper, etc., have sort of grown exponentially. It's not as if everything was hunky-dory before 3 years since the reference period there. So problems have been there ever since my youth as well. There are some efforts done at various times, but they were never, they could not be sustained, at least as far as I know, not really much happened. And then things took a turn. And you know what I'm referring to, and you may not elaborate. I'm sort of reminded of one thing in this context before I start. You know, there was this something called the power of C and so on, and there was a big debate about that. And Amir Khan got into trouble for saying that there is intolerance and so on. I'm not going to the merits of what Amir Khan said or not said. But in addition to saying that there was intolerance, he also said, I actually watched that interview on TV, and he also said that it was not as if there was no intolerance before, but there was always a structure to which you could look up to deal with it. And now, I don't find such a structure. That is, it's not exactly his words, I'm not repeating his words, but that is the spirit in which he conveyed his anxiety. Now, here we are addressing the limited issue of looking at things from a scientific point of view. But you find that the same kind of graph profile is visible with regard to attitude to science as well. The whole aspect of discourse has changed dramatically with the change in the media and so on, WhatsApp and so on. At one time, there was a particular sense of what debate meant. People would not have agreed, but there was a good sense of what gentlemanly debate meant, and you could witness very good debates on the national TV. In fact, there were very good debates on the national TV, and in fact, I remember I had some visitors from abroad, and they were quite struck at the level of tolerant debates with mutual respect that were taking place on Indian TV at that time. But now, it's just impossible to watch a TV debate where people are not at each other's throats, more or less, and really with no respect to each other. So the whole situation somehow changed for the worse in a very rapid way. And I don't know at the social level how things are going to develop. But limiting ourselves to the issue of science, we can sort of think of creating some awareness, some sense of responsibility about how to go about having a rational and responsible society where people can discuss, address questions in a peaceful way and come to conclusion in a what we call democratic setup. Democratic setup doesn't mean that you go by the majority. In fact, if you take majority as the criterion of democracy, in fact, we might actually be the most democratic now rather than any time before, because if you actually take a vote, probably it would in fact be in favor of being not democratic. I mean, if you take a vote whether we should have a dictator, I think with more than 50% people, I'm sure would in some form be voting for that. That's not the issue. Democracy doesn't mean majoritarian rule. Democracy literally translates as people's administration, people's rule. Now, people's rule means that it is by consensus. It's only that certain things that you cannot do by consensus, you cannot have a vote of everybody coming on a particular issue, that you have a way of choosing representatives, and for whatever reasons the constitution has certain kind of a mechanism by which the representatives are chosen, and somehow we have got into the setup of this 50% thing, which goes part of the way towards democracy, but that is not exactly the idea of democracy. Democracy should be tolerant and to each other, and proceed by persuasion and carrying conviction. So this is I'm sort of digressing a bit. Actually, the main part I want to refer from my notes that I have. So, but that's the background in which we had this March for Science, and then there's further discussions about that and so on. And then whatever needs to be done at the social level needs a much bigger fora and so on. But one of the key things that is missing, one of the key factors that we would identify as missing, is the lack of scientific temper. And so if we develop a clearer understanding of what scientific temper should be, how we should be looking at science, how we should be looking at addressing, how to go about addressing our day-to-day questions, we develop a better understanding or educate people around us, discuss with them and so on, then perhaps that could make a difference. And it is with this limited objective that I would personally view this endeavor. Now, contrary to what was said, this is really not my subject. I have no expertise. This is more or less the first talk that I'm giving on this subject. I say more or less because when we set out for this March for Science thing, there was also a meeting at IIT where again I got persuaded to talk as a sort of preamble or initiating process towards the March for Science, and that was my first effort. Now when the idea of holding this monthly, this name Curiosity Circle was developed later, but a meeting of this kind came up. I don't know exactly for what reason the organizers wanted me to be the first speaker. I still don't know the list of speakers that are supposed to be there, but I'm sure I'm easily the oldest. And probably they wanted to start with sage advice of an old man. And normally when something comes my way, when somebody wants to, some people want me to give a talk, or do this or you do that for me, I first see whether it's something that I would fit into. Then the second thing I try to do is to see if I can suggest someone. Unfortunately, in this instance, I could not really come up with any suggestion. And then the third plan C that I have is always like take a deep breath and do whatever you can. And it's in this spirit that I'm going to I'm facing you. So as I said, it's not my expertise. It is not something that I am raring to do, but it's something that I consider my responsibility, given that I'm asked to do it. Okay, so that's roughly the introduction to the talk. So don't expect too much, and I hope presumably even you'll be able to educate me on some of the things that I have to say, and that would be a great pleasure too. Okay. Now, and for the title, when I was thinking of what should be the title of something that I will talk about here. So, of course, the plan is broad, because the plan of the series is quite broad. We want to inculcate scientific understanding on various at various levels, in various aspects, etc. But this is going to be an introductory talk. I just want to chat in a way. I mean, Professor Arun also said that it's really meant to be a more informal communication, so to speak. So, when I was looking for a title, I thought there's a lot of recognition about this power of science. So that's not something that everyone knows that. Now we have this and we have that and we have mobiles, we can talk at long distance and so on and so forth. I mean, in fact, there would be more fantasy events also, things also that one can get on WhatsApp and such media. But what is lacking is that what this entails. Okay, so if we go back to the overall history of humanity, it started with practically no information. So initially we had the hunter-gatherers and so on, and basically the know-how was that could be acquired by the species consisted of various kind of maneuvers by which you could improve your hunting abilities, and then there was agriculture, you could get this. But so the basic, as the know-how began to be gathered, the primary task was to harness it. But as this became, the process became simpler, it could be now with your permission, I will take a chair and follow my notes rather than just be go at random. Yeah, so with accumulation of greater knowledge, there is also the question, the curiosity arose that in the way why things are as they are, right? What makes them so? And at that time, there was really no way of finding out. I'm reminded of the article of Professor Vahia, which you might have seen, where he is talking about there's a rock art specimen which has two bright bodies shown in the sky. And then he discusses at one time, sometime when they saw the two bright objects in the sky, it must have been something unusual. And now, if you find a similar thing, then you can immediately call astronomy person or some of the observatories and so on, and then they'll tell you it's a supernova that is exploded, and you have that's what it is. There is nothing unnatural, supernatural about it. But on the other hand, there's no such possibility at that time, and all they could do is to express themselves by saying that they saw such a thing. So this shows a great limitation of the possibility of explaining things around. So at that time, naturally, the idea came that nature is kind of is governed by something supernatural. I mean, there are various manifestations of the supernatural and out of which ultimately there is the idea of God and so on. And then that became a part of the human psyche for forever, more or less. Began to be gathered, initial impulse was only to harness it. Gradually, there came questions of the nature of the world and whether it has implications to our behavior, both at social and individual level. Since no permanent model for the happenings in nature could come up, a feeling evolved that nature is governed by something supernatural. One of the tasks, therefore, seemed to identify how the supernatural intervened with the nature, with the natural course, and at the same time with the aim to benefit from the understanding of whatever the mechanism of the supernatural. This is both in terms of setting up our goals as well as influential both in terms of setting up goals in terms of, for instance, like going to heaven would be one such aim or objective, attaining moksha, etc. On the other hand, could also think of appeasing the supernatural to have functional benefits in our everyday lives. Now, many principles emanating from this, for example, say that you should have good behavior, so as not to incur the wrath of the agencies of the supernatural, etc., were also convenient for the stability of the society, and therefore acquired a life of their own. Okay, so to be sure, of course, the doubters of this such a model have existed since ancient times as well. And though it's going to be a bit of a digression, I should recall to you about our own culture. There was the so-called Charvaka movement, which dates back to the 6th century BC. I don't know how many of you have heard of Charvaka as Muni and then his tradition, etc. This is a materialist tradition, as I said, it around the 6th century BC. And one of the things that there's not so much information about it on the in public domain, but one of the things that I have known, for instance, may I write in Devanagari? Sukham Jive. Runam Kutva Grutam Tige. The next two lines are Vasmi Bhutasya Dehasya Dehasya Punaragamanam Kutaha. Make a reasonable amount of sense without what a bit. Okay, anyway, good. But nevertheless, I'll explain for the benefit of those who may not be familiar with Sanskrit language as such. So, yavat jivet sukham jivet means that as long as you live happily. Runam krutva gurutam pibe. That is, you can take loan and but ensure that you drink, consume ghee. Gurutam is ghee and pibe is consume, drink, but here in the sense of consume. Now, and then there's a second, it is adjoined with basmi bhutasya dehasya, that is the body that gets cremated. How will it come back from? So punaragaman kutha, where will it come back from? Now of course it's not clear. I mean, the one interpretation that has been common is that this is actually not their motto, but has been sort of twisted to malign the Javaka tradition. That's not clear, but even recently I came across an observation that even if it is their motto, there's actually nothing bad or wrong about it, so long as you interpret it in the correct spirit. Now, the normal interpretation that is taken is that you take loan, and it's assumed that it's implied that you can default on it. But there is no intrinsic sense here that you can default on the loan. Okay? In any healthy society, loans are given only when there is a certain assurance of getting them back. So this aspect that people have in mind, like here, take loan and drink, consume ghee, is just that you take and forget about doing anything else and consume it. That you are not going to get loans from that and then do it. That's not the idea. Okay, again, I was also struck by the explanation that notice that it says ghee and not alcohol, for instance. So it's not that you can take a loan and go to a bar and finish it. That's not what it is. Consuming ghee in our society has always stood for maintaining good health, good wealth. I mean, good health, keeping yourself fit. So, if you see it this way, it's quite consistent with the modern day motto in a very satisfactory sense. So, now there are any number of credit cards, you can have such a card and get whatever the necessities and even a bit of luxury that you would like to have. And because it tells you that once the body is cremated, it doesn't come back. It's not. Okay, so this is a bit of digression which I thought I should introduce, because the materialist culture of basic independence of human entity is something that has been recognized in our culture as well for a long time.